Good afternoon, church family. Welcome to this Wednesday edition of Staying Connected. I'm Jeremy Cole, the youth pastor here at St. Mary's United Methodist Church. As always, it is a joy and honor to greet you with God's word and prayer. Today, we are continuing our series called Red Letters, where we look in the Gospel of John, at specifically in the letters that are in red, Jesus' words. If you have a red letter Bible, you'll see that when Jesus spoke, and it's always in red. So today we're continuing on with that. We're just journeying through the Gospel of John, and we're picking up now in John chapter 3, verses 1 through 21. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs that you are doing if God were not with him." Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. How can someone be born when they are old?" Nicodemus asked, "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb and be born." Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of the water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, 'You must be born again.' The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." "How can this be?" Nicodemus asked. "You are Israel's teacher," said Jesus, "and you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know, and we testify to what we have seen, but still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that they may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So just a few things to focus on there. First, just want to kind of give you some background, tell you the story of what brings us to this moment in the gospel. So we have the Pharisee Nicodemus, one of the Jewish leaders, not necessarily a priest or a rabbi, but a Jewish lay person, a lay servant and a lay leader in the Jewish church, and had great standing, had some influence, had some power. And the what was typical with the Pharisees in Jesus' time is that most of them were not for Jesus. They were ultimately trying to catch him in some sort of incriminating offense that they could bring before trial, which ultimately they try to do, which leads to Jesus being crucified on the cross. But Nicodemus is a different than the rest of the Pharisees, as we see here. He is curious about Jesus, so he comes to meet him in secret in the night. And what happens there is that Jesus doesn't necessarily judge him or turn him away or condemn him, but he takes time to listen to him, and he meets him right where he is. And I think that's just a great model of how we should meet folks that might be just the unexpected people that we think would be curious about a life serving Jesus. So there they are in the night. If you watch a Bible movie about Jesus, they're usually around a fire, and they're just sitting there having a fireside chat. And Jesus, like I said, doesn't condemn Nicodemus, but instead he speaks some really powerful truth into him. He tells him that, you know, man's deeds that are done in darkness cannot be hidden from the light of, God. He says that, you know, you people, he's talking about him and others that are not buying into this way of life that Jesus is preaching. He said, you are rejecting this this way and this light and this truth that I've come to spread. And he's saying that all of that will be brought to light. And he's doing it in a really just not judgmental way, but I would say a convicting way that is challenging Nicodemus. We see later on in the gospel that Jesus must have challenged him pretty deeply, because Nicodemus arranged for a burial. He was instrumental in arranging a burial place for Jesus after the crucifixion, when people that were crucified typically didn't have a burial. So Jesus is giving us this model of, I think, of where we should meet those that are curious about the faith, especially those that are just unlikely, that maybe our initial instinct would be to not engage them in their curiosities, that we might feel like they're not so much curious as they are trying to debate and slip us up. But that's not the case here with Jesus and Nicodemus. So lastly, that makes me think, you know, who are those Nicodemuses in our lives? Like, we've all got somebody in our life that we should be praying for to come to Christ, but we also got people in our lives that we have been praying for that are curious about a relationship with Christ. And I think we should be wise and follow the example of Jesus and how we should meet them and have those conversations with them. That we shouldn't do it in a condemning and judgmental way, but a very truth-filled way that will convict their hearts and help plant seeds of transformation through that. So I think in this particular scripture, Jesus has given us a great roadmap to follow when it comes to meeting people where they are and giving a kind and graceful ear to listen to them, but also speak very powerful and transforming and loving and convicting truth into their lives. So pray that we all have opportunities to live out this example of Jesus that we've learned about today. And now let's go to God in prayer. God, we thank you for your love. Thank you for these particular red letters today that teach us that we are called to meet our brothers and sisters where they are, that we are called to just give a kind and gracious ear to the hurts that they have, to the questions they may have, but then we are also called to speak your truth into their lives and point you in the direction of your life-giving word and truth, that it can totally transform their lives. We pray now that you'll provide us opportunities to meet our fellow brothers and sisters where they are, to have these types of conversations. We pray that you will stir the hearts of those that do not believe you and just draw them near to you and give us opportunities to plant seeds of transforming love in the lives of our neighbors and all those closest to us, and even some of those that aren't as close to us. We just thank you for your love, God. Thank you for this word today. In your son's name.